Good morning. On behalf of the management, principal, and faculty members of Dr. M.G.R. Janki College of Arts and Sciences Women, I would like to welcome you all to the eye-opener session on Role of Women from Ancient Wisdom. We will start the day with an invocation to seek the blessing of the Almighty.
Sharade vidyarayini dayanide sharade vidyarayini dayanide sharade mata sarashvati bhojo prabhasini narayani jyoti kamalasini mata sarashvati bhojo prabhasini narayani jyoti kamalasini hamsa vahini kamala lochani vani saraswati palayamma hamsa vahini kamala lochani vani saraswati palayamma sharade sharade vidyarayini dayanite sharade sharade.
Thank you, Dakshayani. I would like to formally welcome our correspondent, Dr. Lata Rajendran, Chairman, Mr. Kumar Rajendran, Principal, Dr. R. Mani Mekhalai, Vice Principal, Dr. Lakshmi Balaji, Dean Academics, Dr. V.C. Shanti Lakshmi, Dean Students, Dr. Apita Sabhapati, all faculty members and dear students to this session. Eye-openers have been a part of the culture of our college, and we have had numerous eminent speakers from different walks of life to share their life experiences in diverse fields. This practice has been beneficial in introducing our students to different perspectives and insights. This being the first eye-opener session of our Silver Jubilee year, we are proud to have with us today D.K. Hari and Hema Hari, founders of Bharat Gyan, a civilizational study initiative to compile and present the knowledge of India, its traditions, its culture, and its global ties from an Indian perspective. They have traveled extensively to over 30 countries to understand those civilizations, their culture, and knowledge. With factual content on 108 different subjects on the state of knowledge in India, its traditions, and its sustainable practices, compiled over 15 years of dedicated research, the Hari couple have evolved into subject matter experts on the overall understanding of India across ages from over 8,000 years ago to the present. They have given a few hundred lectures across India and the globe to wide audiences. Based on their research, they have authored till date over 22 books and produced 5 documentaries, as well as mini short films that span a wide spectrum of disciplines, such as creation, a trilogy on the history of Rama, a trilogy on the history of Krishna, to name a few. It is indeed a pleasure to have you both with us today. Before we start the session, there are some general instructions to the participants. If you have any questions, you may post them in the chat window. They will be answered after the presentation. The feedback link will be shared in the chat window towards the end of the session. Kindly fill in the feedback form to receive your e-certificates within 3 days. Without further ado, may I request Hari sir and Hema ma'am to take over the session.
Thank you. Wish you all a very happy Navratri, and we'd like to start speaking about your wonderful college and your Madam Dr. Lata Rajendran, who's been doing a wonderful job along with all the colleagues, principal, staff, everyone of you over the last 25 years in building up this college so well. And today it is one of the landmarks of Chennai. Earlier also it was a great landmark of Chennai in a different field of film and entertainment. Now it's a landmark of Chennai in the field of education. And the effort that all of you have put through, the whole team, dedicated team over the last 25 years is commendable and is to be appreciated, all of you. Kudos to you for your wonderful journey of 25 years, and look forward to the next 25 years and more of an even better journey going forward. So we'll get to the subject of the season, which is Navratri, the 9 nights and the 10th day, Dashara.
And we are going to see as to why we celebrate Navratri. I mean, many of you would already be well-versed, you know, having celebrated it right from your childhood. You would be aware of how it is celebrated, what all do you do in these 9 days and everything. But what we are going to look today is why do we celebrate Navratri? How all, in for what reasons is it celebrated? And why in the nights? And why 9 days? Why at this time of the year? Why not at some other time of the year? Why during this period? So all your whys, we'll try to look at all the whys. So, and hope it makes us wiser. She started off with Sharade, one who can sharpen our intellect. So let us see if this will make us wiser at the end of the session.
And all this is intrinsically related to women. Every aspect of Shakti, every aspect of Devi, every aspect of on earth is related to womanhood, because earth itself is an embodiment of the womanhood. That's the beauty of it.
So we will share our screen, and we are actually going to walk you through various formats in which we have compiled and shared this information, so that you will also be able to see where all they are and, you know, follow up further with it. And so we will share our screen and we'll take it from there. Good.
Can you all see the screen share now?
Yes, I guess.
Yes, I guess all of you can see the screen share.
Okay.
Ma'am? Is the screen share visible? Yes, good, good, good. Thank you. Yeah. Good. Now, this festival of Navratri and Dashera is a festival that's celebrated across this land, this country, the civilization of India in different ways, in different forms. Right from the north to the south, each one of it. Let's take the north. Of course, we know how we celebrate it here, but let's look at some in Kashmir. Since you started off with Sharada, the land of Kashmir is a land of Sharada Devi. Actually, Kashmir, she's also known by the name Kashmira Puravasini, about which we have written a book. It's there in our website. You can do it free read. Now, this, look at how they celebrated it in the year 1922. It's a photograph about 100 years ago photograph in Kashmir, the celebration of Dashera. All the people are on, and in the background, you can see the famous chinar trees of Kashmir. Look at this wonderful chinar trees, which you have seen in some of the old black and white movies. That's a thing there. Look at that, beautiful. And look at the size of these effigies. And look at the size of the people there. Look at the effigy size. Then you come to Kulu Manali. I'm sure all of you have heard of Kulu Manali, a wonderful valley. This is the place of Hidimba, Hidimbi, and Ghatotkacha. I'm sure all of you have learned the stories of Ghatotkacha and Hidimba, his mother, Bhima's wife. So this is the valley. Look at the beautiful valley. This is the temple in Manali for Hidimba, the mother of Ghatotkacha, the wife of Bhima. And here, the Dashera procession is so famous here. Up in the mountains of the Himalayas, in Himachal. Look at this.
So much so that Kulu is also called the Valley of the Gods.
Valley of the Gods, yes.
It's one of the best times to visit this place, because that's when you will see all these village gods coming out on a procession. It's the one of the largest festivals of Kulu.
So they have dance, they have music, every aspect of such a beautiful festival. There it is.
The temples may be very small, you know. They say Murti is small, but the Kirti is very big.
Mind is up in the hills, high up in the hills, this temple. Then we come down to Punjab.
Punjab Haryana belt.
There, interestingly, the way we celebrate our Navratri Dashera here in the month of September, October, there they celebrate it in the month of February. We'll see why. We'll see that. And they call it Saraswati Puja. They call it Basanta Panchami. The Basanta Ritu. Basanta Ritu is spring. And look at this. The color of the field in that month is all yellow, along with the turban of this elderly gentleman here, the Sardar. Look at the yellow, miles and miles of yellow. So the land itself is yellow there for you. It has a yellow carpet. And that's why you have the phrase called Rang De Basanti. Of course, it was late. In the recent times, a decade back, it was made popular by a film called Rang De Basanti. And there's also a song called Rang De Basanti. All this traces its origins from this particular color, yellow, which is the color of the landscape, color of the season. And it's called Basanta Panchami.
And they call that their Saraswati Puja. So while we celebrate our Saraswati Puja here during October, I mean this Navratri, which is normally called a Sharadiya Navratri, this Sharada is not to do with Sharada, but Sharad, the season, Sharad Ritu. So Sharadiya Navratri, they have Basant Navratri. And for them, Saraswati Puja is during the spring. And see, it is because, see, this fundamentally, I don't know how many of you are aware, but this region of Haryana is the main region for the Saraswati flow. The wide flow of Saraswati River was through this region, Haryana, Rajasthan, and she drained into Gujarat. So that is why looking, you know, and along this belt, you will find these mustard fields which bloom and then give the shade of color of yellow. So which is why Saraswati is also associated with yellow in these parts of the land.
And this is all about 1830. That's almost 200 years back. And at the times of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, how they celebrate Dashera there, all that. So that's that festival there. And if you go to Baluchistan, Quetta, where Hingalaj Mata Shakti Peeth is, look at this. 90 years back, they celebrated Dashera there. Beautiful. This is the westernmost part of Bharatavarsha. It's there. And you come to in Delhi, when the then Prime Minister was Lal Bahadur Shastri, you have the Dashera festival there. Look at this. In the Ramlila Maidan, which is now being telecast this time for the first time in Doordarshan, it's being telecast live. Okay. And this Saraswati Puja here in Kathmandu, Nepal. Look at the style of the headdress, everything. Of course, they also celebrated it in Basanta Panchami, that is held in at the end of January, February, that period.
Now, I just want you all to make a mental note. See, we said Haryana is where the Saraswati River flows and it's so yellow, and therefore they are celebrating Navratri. I mean, their Navratri in Basant time, spring time, they call their Saraswati Puja then. But look at it, this is in Nepal. There is no Saraswati there as a river. But they also call their Saraswati Puja in the Vasant Ritu, springtime. Please make a note of this. We will see why later.
And this is there at that temple there. Same, this is a temple for Saraswati where all artisans, musicians, everybody come there. And look at this in Nepal. Look at the wonderful headdresses they have on. So colorful, so beautiful, so vibrant. The whole culture of the civilization is so vibrant, beautiful. And look at this, what they do, the way we do for Vijayadashami, what do? They also plant all the Navadaniam sprouts and all these things, and then have the sindoor for that. And for all the nine plants, the names of nine plants and some of the English translations we have here, each one of their plants. Beautiful, isn't it? Now let's come to Ramlila in Uttar Pradesh, one of the famous ones in different parts of India. This, of course, they celebrated for the commemoration of Rama killing Ravana. So that's what it celebrated. So Ravana, Kumbhakarna, Meghnath, huge effigies they make with crackers, pataka, and then they burst. And look at this. This is a painting of almost 200 years ago in Banaras, Ramnagar. Banaras, Varanasi is to the south of the Ganga River. Ramnagar is to the north of the Ganga River, which is at the palace of the Kashi Nareshes. The Kashi Naresh comes down from the date of Mahabharata.
Kashi kings.
The kings of Kashi. If you look at the story of Mahabharata, which most of you would have heard in Doordarshan, the famous Mahabharata episode, they will speak about the name Kashi Naresh. His palace is in Ramnagar, which we happened to go there a few years back, it seems. Look at this painting there of Ravana and this. Look at the beautiful painting. This is 200-year-old painting by a Britisher. And look at all this here. Hanuman and all that here. So very nicely done. And this is a those days painting by James Prinsep in 1834 of the same Ramlila Maidan in Ramnagar. Look at how they are spelling Nagar then, N-U-G-U-R. The spelling 200 years back. And the description of how Ramlila started was one of the early times, about 475 years ago, when Goswami Tulsidas was over 80 years back, and that's the time they had the Ramlila there. So this initiative of Ramlila starts from that period. Look at this. So it's almost a 500-year-old festival. Continuous tradition of this land going across centuries. Look at the beauty of it. And then they have the festival of Bharat Milap. Milap is what Johnny Milan, coming together. Milna, meet. So after the, when he comes back after the 14 years of exile, Rama, Lakshmana, Sita, they meet. So there's a reunion of Bharat Milap. That's also part of this festival there. Like, similarly, if you go to Assam, you celebrate it by the Kamakhya temple, again a Shakti Peet, in the eastern part of India by the Brahmaputra river. It's called Kumari Puja. They do for all the Kumaris. This is in Nepal, it's in Assam. Different parts, you have the Kumari Puja. Look at all the young girls, so beautiful. So they do Kumari Puja here. So this is in the Kamakhya temple on the banks of the Brahmaputra river. Actually, when the Brahmaputra river is in spate, is in floods, the waters will come up to the feet of the Kamakhya Devi. That's the beauty of it. Then you come to Bengal, the famous Durga Puja. Vijayadashmi. Look at that. So Durga Puja. So different parts of the land. And here is associated with Mahishasura Mardini, which we'll see a little later, how this idea. And we also got a film on Mahishasura Mardini in our YouTube channel, which you can all watch. It's there. And look at this painting again. It's almost 200-year-old painting of Durga Puja in a house in Calcutta. Look at the pillars of the house, the structure, how grand it looks. The puja festivals and the dancers doing the puja. There's another painting in Calcutta of this about 150-year-old painting. You can see picture of it. Then you come to the Dashera here, which is in the army campaign. So war campaign, Mewar, about again 200 years back in the army, how they celebrate Dashera. So we celebrate Ayudha Puja. They also have Ayudham. All these are Ayudham. So they do puja for all the Ayudham here. So it's Ayudha Puja there for them. Then you come to Gujarat, the famous Dandiya Ras that you celebrate there in Gujarat. Then you come down south to Dasheras. Look at this. This is in Hampi. You have this big platform, granite platform. It's called the Mahanavami Dibba. Mahanavami Dibba is 500 years old. Sculpted so beautifully in Hampi. I'm sure many of you in your lifetime will get the good opportunity of visiting Hampi. Spend a day, because this is not this Mahanavami Dibba is just open Dibba. It's an open, huge platform. Spend a day to go around. Each is a Dibba here like this. But look at the sculptures in each of this is built specifically to celebrate Mahanavami by Krishnadeva Raya. Of his all his victories and all this. Look at this Mahanavami. Each sculpture, they tell a story of the whole Navaratri Mahanavami celebration. Look at this. Everything is about a story. The grand story, spectacle. That's what it is. And different travelers who came to Vijayanagara over the years, they have all written about this, starting from Niccolo Conti to Abdul Razak, who came from Herat, that's in Afghanistan. Then Domingo Pérez, to every one of them, they've written about continuously for 300 years. They've written about how this Mahanavami Navaratri has been celebrated there. And look at the staircase to this Mahanavami Dibba, where the people go sit, all the royalty sit here and watch the whole procession happening. This is, and look at this beautiful sculptures, amazingly wonderful sculptures that are there in the Mahanavami Dibba. Look at the dance poses. I'm sure many of you are into dance, learning dance, appreciation of dance. Look at this steps and the dress that you wear today for you doing a Bharatanatyam dance, all these poses. So amazing. So beautiful, isn't it? So this is the Mahanavami Dibba there, the detail about it is there. Then when you come down, that is where, that is in Hampi, is in northern part of Karnataka. That procession that was then done in the Mahanavami Dibba has now come down south to Mysuru, where you have the famous Dashera celebrations, Navratri celebrations in Mysuru. Beautiful celebrations you have there. So how started off here 500 years back, now it has moved down south and celebrated here. Similarly, if you look at Andhra Pradesh also, you have the same different villages, you have the Navratri festival in different, just like you have in Uttar Pradesh, same celebrated here also. Then you come to the Saraswati Puja in down south. How do we celebrate it? Two ways. One is by having beautiful Kolu, be it in Thirunapuram or Chennai or Bangalore or Andhra Pradesh, all the wonderful dolls, Channapatna dolls, to all the Kondapalli dolls, to the Puducherry, Man Bommai, Tanjavur Bommai. Each place has got Bommai. Look at this. This is a full Kolu set in the Srirangam temple. Look at the set of how they celebrate Kolu. Look at the, each one is different. Full set inside the Srirangam temple. So the temples used to celebrate here. You see Andal here, see? Andal Kondai. So the stories, the Puranic stories are set in these places and celebrated so beautifully. So a temple is not just a place of worship, a temple is a place of celebration where you have a full range of Navratri Kolu. Probably this is one of the grand Kolus. Many temples had these Kolus right through the ages. Unfortunately, in the last few decades, it's come down. Look at this here. Sharada Devi here. Each one is a panel there. Wonderful Kolu. See? Amazingly beautiful in the temple. So then you come down to how on the 10th day you have Akshar Abhyasam, wherein they start children from starting to learn. So it's a day of learning. So they teach the child how to learn. So different places, they have these communities where they do this across the land. So it's a beautiful way of you celebrate across the land. And what is, when you say Dashara, it is Dasahara. Hara is defeat. Okay. Hara. So you defeat something. So there are, it's mentioned in Shabda Kalpa Druma. It's a famous text where it sends a 10 sins. 3 relate to the body, 4 relate to speech, and 3 relate to the mind. So what are the 10? So how it is? The false pride, wishing for others, self-thinking. So all these are the 10 sins that you can. So all this is there. Actually, it's there in our article to read in our mini book and our article. You can read that. So the harshness of words, lying. So unrelated, useless, loose talk. So each one of these are harassing others without valid reason. So each of these sins. So that is what we overcome actually. And look at it.
So,
okay. See, when you go to the Mahabharata, this is again celebrated there. This Mahanavami and Ayudha Puja, can trace it to 5,100 years back to the Mahabharata text, where, you know, they all were forced to go on exile, the Pandavas, after the game they played in dice. So what did they do? They went on exile. At that time, they kept all their weapons hid in a tree. It's called a Shami tree. Okay, this is the botanical name of the tree. So it's on the Shami tree. They hid all the weapons and went on Agyatvas. So they were incognito, as you say in English nowadays. So that's the day they came back to pick up their, to retrieve their weapons, hidden weapons. So also they did puja for their weapons after keeping it for 1 year and came back. So Ayudha Puja, again you trace back. See how beautifully. So it's a tradition. It's not a 20, 30, 50 year old tradition. The 5,000 year old tradition we have in this land. And that is where the Shamitri, look at this. They celebrate all over for this. Mahakali, Shamitri celebrate all over. And it's also astronomical.
So fundamentally now what we have seen is, if you look at it, you find that the times, there are different times in the year when it is still considered Navratri. People have celebrated Navratri. And there are some which are very common. So, but Saraswati here is in October, whereas there it is in springtime, whereas in some places it's celebrated for Ram Leela. So the seasons are different, sometimes the reasons are different, and also many, many times. And fundamentally though, however, there is a common connect. It is to do with Ratri, Navaratri, as the name itself goes. So why do we talk about Ratri? What is so special about Ratri? So I would just request Dr. Ragita to play a very small film, 2-3 minuter. We will see that and then we'll explain to you the significance of the nights. Dr. Ragita, could you just, I will stop the screen share.
She suppose she can take over.
Yes. Dr. Ragita, can you present?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Every year, we celebrate the Ratri with fervor and gaiety. It is a night full of piety. It is a night full of singing devotional songs and chanting the name of Shiva. A night full of awakening, celebrating and understanding Shiva Tattva. It is one of the holiest festivals celebrated by Hindus all over. Have you paused to wonder why do we celebrate Shivaratri and why do we celebrate it as the night of Shiva?
Shivaratri is one such festival for people to reach out and be in communion with the divinity called Shiva. It is not a night of Shiva, but a night with Shiva. You may ask, why is this festival celebrated as a night-long festival and not a day festival? To answer this question, we must first understand the meaning of the word Ratri or night and the role of Ratri.
The word Ratri means comfort giver. Ratri is that which gives one comfort or rest from three types of activities. Kayika, bodily actions. Vachika, speech. Manasika, thoughts. During the night, when a person sleeps, it is a restful state for all activities of body and mind. Hence, night is called Ratri or comfort giver. For man, this natural rhythm is daily, day and night. Every night, the body gets regenerated and refreshed for the next day. Blood in the body is purified and circulated. Old cells are discarded and get replaced with new cells every day. What does this night and regeneration concept have to do with Shiva?
Shiva is the divinity for dissolution and regeneration. For only if there's dissolution is there scope for regeneration for the new.
Dissolution and regeneration is a continuous cycle. Dissolution is known as pralaya.
From time immemorial, our ancestors have given this night of regeneration a feeling of serenity through fasting and praying, followed by celebration with singing. Why is this Shivaratri called Mahashivaratri or the Great Shivaratri? Does that mean that there are other Shivaratris too?
Not so well known is the monthly celebration of Shivaratri, which falls on the Krishna Paksha Chaturdasi every month, or the night preceding the monthly Amavasya new moon. Mahashivaratri, we celebrate annually the Krishna Paksha Chaturdasi night. That is, the night before Amavasya, new moon in the month of Magha, which now occurs in the month of February, March.
Dr. Ragita, you can stop it. Huh? So actually, therefore, you know, you would have got, while this is about Shivaratri, I mean, this will kind of set the trend for understanding Navaratri. That is why we wanted to play it for you. See, the word Ratri is also, it comes from the root Ra, Rama, which means that which is pleasing, soothing, comforting. That is why Rama is one who is a comforter. He's very soothing. And that is why everybody craved for Rama. They loved Rama because of his very nature of being a comforter. And that is how you get Ratri, which is a comforting period for in a person's life of a day.
That's why we have in the Tamil language the word Ramyam, meaning soothing, something pleasant, pleasing. Ramyam, isn't it? We have a word used in poetry, in a lot of literature in Tamil.
So, comes from that. So the night is actually a rejuvenator. A night is the balancer because it puts to halt your mind, your thought, your actions. So all of these, your speech. So speech, action, and thought, all three come to a still and you are at rest. Now you understood, you would have seen how Shivaratri itself is not just once a year, but every month. The learned and people who know about it, they celebrate it once every month to align themselves and all the energies around them.
Yeah, so the yoga is not just doing yoga asana. Yoga is alignment. So it's bringing together of these three, your speech, your thought, your mind together every month with the alignment of the sun, earth, moon, which is Amavasya. So there's a celestial alignment of earth, sun, moon coming together for Amavasya. There's alignment in your mind. That is why you come to rest, you come to peace. That's when you appreciate the beauty of both this inner self and the self in the sky. Same way you do it for Navaratri also, which is what she'll explain.
So Navaratri, like that, so the way Shivaratri is 12 in number, Navaratri is actually 4 in number. From time immemorial, we've been celebrating Navaratri 4 times a year. That is why you see in the north, in Haryana and all, you find it around spring. Whereas here in the south, we have focused more around the autumn. Now the question will be, why do we have 4 Navaratris? So let us go and quickly look at.
Anybody wants to sort of guess as to why we have 4 Navaratris? Would you want to put on the chat box, anybody? Why 4 Navaratris a year? Why Shivaratri, we have 12 because 12 months. Navaratri, why 4? Pause for a moment to think, any of you.
And in the meanwhile, we'll show you the reason. See, we all know about the sun. You all have studied this in your geography about how when seen from the earth, while the earth is actually going around the sun, when seen from the earth, the sun seems to oscillate between the two tropics, the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. And when it is passing just above the equator, that is when the day and nights are equal. When it is at Tropic of Cancer in the north, that is when you have one of the solstices, the summer solstice. And when it is around Capricorn, you have the winter solstice. So at this period, you're in the winter solstice, your days are shorter and nights are longer, while in the summer solstice, your days are longer and nights are shorter. So what happens is, at these two extremes, you really can find the seasons changing very drastically. And therefore, with every of these season change is when they have celebrated the Navaratris. So each of these seasonal changes was a time that they wanted to bring their body in alignment with the change in season. So this became the Sharadiya Navaratri. This became the, and look at the interesting thing. See, when you're at the equinox, today we prominently celebrate two of the Navaratris, that is the winter and spring and autumn. Whereas these two, since the day and night are almost equal and it is a sense of balance, these two have taken a little backseat in our celebrations. While the north has been celebrating the transition into spring because that is ushering in warmth and better days for them. Because predominantly those regions, if you see Tropic of Cancer and above, much of the time they are cold, and for them warmth, they are really seeking that warmth, Kashmir, Kulu, Nepal and all those regions. Whereas in the south, for predominantly most of the time it is warmer. So when it is transitioning into autumn and winter, that is when it's becoming more, a more salubrious climate. And therefore, you are celebrating that change there so that you can better utilize that salubrious period. And this is why we celebrate more during autumn, while they celebrate more during spring.
So you can see that when you have when the sun is at the Tropic of Cancer, it's peak heat time. When it's at the Tropic of Capricorn, it's the cold time. So it's when it's here, it is an average. So it is moving from Aries to others. So that's when you celebrate the two Navratris, look at it. So one is the spring, one is the autumn Navratri. So how your four Navratris are intertwined with nature and the movement of the sun up and down, and it's touching one either of two ends or crossing the center, either it is northward journey or southward journey. Look at it, how your four Navratris a year is intertwined with nature, intertwined with the sun movement. It's a beautiful, it's a celebration of nature.
So, and now we have seen why the focus has been given to the night, because night is when your body can rejuvenate better. So that is why sleep is also considered to be very important. So the nights become the rejuvenator. So now the question will come, why nine nights? Why not just one day? So if you look at it, these kind of transitions of seasons, they do not happen instantaneously. It is a very gradual process. And our ancestors have understood that it takes about 9 day period for this to get aligned. I will just show you where you can read more about this.
It is available in our book, in our website for free read for all of you, which we have shared with Dr. Agita Radakshi Madam and as well as the principal madam. So it's available there where we speak about this. It's there in our article book. So you get four Navratris for the equinox and the solstice, and it is the period of the Sandhi. All of you heard of the term in Tamil called Sandai. That's a market. Marketplace where we all meet. Sandipu, the meeting of places. So Sandhi, the joining of the seasons. Overlap of one season over the other. So it is not a cutoff of one finishes, other starts. No, it's an overlap. It overlaps over each other. So that's why you have the term Sandhi where you meet. That's why a railway station junction is called what? Sandipu. Because the trains meet there. So that's why. So the transition period is not just 1 hour or 1 minute or 1 day. It is actually 9 days, nine nights. So that is how the change happens. Your body adapts to the change of the season. That is how it happens. So how beautifully they realize that the body, our body and Earth's body have to align and change with the changing seasons four times a year.
And so now why nine? Right. So we understood nights. We understand that, okay, it is a period. It's not just a one day, one night affair, but it has to be gradual over a few days. Now, why night? Now, here is where you will find a beautiful link. See, we saw in Shivaratri or in night, fundamentally in a night, what are the three things that come to rest? Your thoughts, your action, and your speech. So what do they denote? Your thought denotes desire. A wish, your actions, they denote your acting, your energies, you're not doing anything, you're at rest. The third is your speech. What does speech denote? It denotes your intellect. So these three, if you look at it, they are our Ichha Shakti, desire or will to act, Kriya Shakti, which is the energies and the potential to act actually, and Dhyana Shakti, which is your energy, I mean, a thought of the wisdom, the speech. And these three, to align these three is where.
When you say Kriya Shakti, because you have the word Karam, Kar, hand, Karam, Karate, okay, Karatandam, so Kar. So that is why you have to do action is by hands. Icha, it's what you desire. See, and Jnanam. So all these are very clear words that used in Tamil regularly to come up with these words, and how it's so beautifully intertwined.
So what they did is for these three divinities, I mean, so these three energies, which is the Ichha Shakti, the Kriya Shakti and the Jnana Shakti, They have set aside three nights for aligning each of these three, for you to bring in alignment all these three aspects of your daily life. And the first three were set aside for Saraswati, the second three were for Lakshmi, and the last three for Durga. So that is how they, over a period of 9 nights, were therefore dedicated as this transition period to align in all these three forms of energies. And that is how we have ended up celebrating it as a 9-night festival, a Navaratri. And the 10th day is when it is a Dashami. It is a day or and a Vijaya Dashami. So fundamentally, in those Dashamis, when there are certain alignments of the satellite, the Earth, Sun, and the star, they end up being called Vijaya Dashami. So that means a day of conquering. So this 10th day, Vijaya Dashami, is the day you conquer all these, you conquer yourself in that sense. You align and bring all of these into balance, and that therefore it becomes a day of Vijaya Dashami. And incidentally, since Rama killed Ravana on this day, it is also therefore celebrated as Ram Leela. That is why you also find many parts of India celebrating Ram Leela around this period. And all of this is a celebration. That is why you find people celebrating it with Dandiya Ras and then celebrating it as Golu in the form of Golu and so on. So this brings out that it is a 9-day period of rejuvenating yourself, which is why if you look at it, many people during Navratri, they observe Vrat, Vratam. And the word Vrat itself, you know, is a beautiful word. It means to keep yourself contained. See, Vratam, Vrat doesn't mean rituals alone. It means to contain, keep yourself contained. And it comes from, one of the fundamental idea comes from the word Vritra. Vritra means to hold back, to hold in. So there is a demon who is called Vritra because he opposes Indra. When Indra tries to expand, and when the world, when, you know, this goes back to the story of creation, when the universe in its unmanifested form is trying to expand because of Indra, this is how it is explained in the Veda. Vritra tries to hold it back. So it's an oscillation between an expanding force and a contracting force.
This is available as a film in our YouTube channel, which you can see later. Because of paucity of time, we're not able to show you everything. But the same, what he's talking about now, Indra, Vritra, the Asura, Vritra, and Indra Deva, what is happens in the Hiranyagarbha is there as a short film you can watch, and also as an article.
So Vrit means to contain. So you contain all your thoughts, your desire, your actions. So you this is a period where you keep yourself as calm and still as possible.
That is why when you celebrate, all your ladies must be celebrating Varalakshmi Vritam. What do? You bring a container in a pot with water. So Vritam. So when you bring everything together.
But there you are trying to bring in all prosperity and auspiciousness. And in the case of Navratri Vritam, you are trying to align your body and the three energies, which are the three Ichha Shakti, Kriya Shakti and Jnana Shakti in the universe. Now, why is Navratri a period to celebrate women? Why are women given more importance? It is because fundamentally these three energies, if you see, they are depicted in the feminine form. In our Indian thought itself, if you look at it, women, Hari and I, we normally call them women of substance. Because if you look at the whole, how in thought, in Indian thought, we have described the functioning of the universe.
How many of you follow up the beauty pageants of the world, Miss Universe, Miss Madras, Miss College, Miss Tamil Nadu, Miss South India, Miss India, all of you would have come across all these things, right? All the beauty pageants that all lead up, Femina, Miss World, all those things. But what is the tagline of all these beauty pageants? It says, women of substance. Let us see in reality, in our Indian thought, in our civilizational thought, how all these women at the supreme level are actually the real substance. So what you call an advertising tagline today is in reality the fact at the celestial level, at the cerebral level, at the civilization level.
So for instance, we all have the three trinities. I mean, we have the trinity, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, right? And they are associated with three major tasks in the functions that happen in creation, in the cosmos. One is the creation of the cosmos, which is attributed to Brahma as the creator. And then you have the sustenance of the cosmos, which is attributed to Vishnu as the sustainer or preserver. And unfortunately, people associate Shiva with destruction. Rather, it should be rejuvenation. That is why you have Shivaratri as a night for rejuvenation. Shiva, the very word itself means auspiciousness, Mangalam. Shiva means Mangalam. That is why, and what does auspicious mean? Because it means that, what do you say when you say something has to be rejuvenated, when you say something has to be recycled, something has to be destroyed and then recreated. So this process of transitioning from one form to another is what Shiva is associated with. And because of this, he is auspicious, because he's bringing you something new again. So he's converting from old into new. So the potential of making something new is that auspiciousness in Shiva. So more than destroyer, he should be seen as a rejuvenator. So these three major functions, look at who they have as their spouses. So these spouses add the spice actually to all their function. You have Brahma with Saraswati, who is associated with knowledge. Because for the process, act of creation, it's supported by knowledge. Knowledge is a very, very limiting way of describing Saraswati. She's actually, if Brahma is not just creator as somebody who makes, Brahma makes space. He is responsible for evolution. It is from his word, the root Brahma, Bra, which means to expand. So in creation, he expands, keeps expanding and making the space for things to be evolve and happen in that space. So that is why he's Brahma.
When she said the word Bra means to make space, all of you know the big temple in Tanjavur, which was built by Rajaraja Chola about 1,010 years back. What is the temple called now? Brihad Ishwar temple. Ishwar for divine. Ishwar, Brihad, big. So, okay. So, what do you call Jupiter in Tamil? Brihaspati, Nakshatram, right? So Brihad is big because Jupiter is a big planet. Okay, so Brih there means big, expanding. Similarly, for Mumbai, what do you call it? Mumbai as Brihad Mumbai. Greater Mumbai, called Brihad Mumbai. So, Brih means B-R-H, Brih means big. So
expanding.
Hmm?
So, and Saraswati actually is the entire medium of this expanded space. The medium which contains all the knowledge and everything, all the vibrations around in the knowledge, in the universe. So that is Saraswati. So it's knowledge is just very limiting. She's much beyond that. So this Brahma has this Saraswati as his consort. Vishnu, the sustainer, now to sustain, to preserve, what do you need? You need resources. You also need a goal. So the goal, look at the word Lakshmi. It comes from Lakshya. That who's...
Tamil, we have to Lakshyam. We have to do something. What do you have? Lakshyam. You have to go towards a goal. If you don't have a goal, you don't know what to achieve. You don't know which side to go. You have a goal in your exam to score as many marks as possible. In some subjects, you can score 100 centum. Some subjects you score in high 90s. When you play your games, what do you want to play? Points to win the game, isn't it? So you have a goal to achieve. When you cook food in your house, what do? You want to make as tasty, nutritious, healthy food as possible. So you have a goal. So in every activity of your life, you have a goal to do. Every hour, every moment of your life, there's a goal. You want to do something. When you breathe, what? You breathe to live. So every activity, so the act of preserving has a goal attached to it. That is why earning wealth is also a goal, so Lakshmi. So it's not gold alone, it's not Lakshmi. So Lakshyam is a nice word that we have in Tamil for a goal. So that's,
and if you did have such a goal, you would never do anything. So that is how you get your, that's why she's associated with wealth, all forms of wealth, because she makes you do something. She makes you act. She gives you that goal to act. So that is how she is the consort of the sustainer, Vishnu. And finally, when you come to it, if you have to regenerate, when you have to change something from one form to another, and when you have to manifest something, especially in a material form, then you need Shakti. So that is how Shakti is the consort of Shiva. So if you look at it, all these forms of the underlying substance needed to for the functioning principles themselves. So the essence of all these principles are these three energies. So Lakshmi, Saraswati and Shakti. So Durga. So that is how you see that the women, and because the Indian thought has represented in the masculine and feminine form, energies have come to be associated with women. And that is how when you celebrate the 9-day period, when you celebrate energies, when you try to align the energies, that period is also come to be as the period for celebrating womanhood.
When you don't have this energy, what do you call it? When you're tired, you're energyless, when you are fatigued, what do you call that? When you have fatigue, what do you think of it as when fatigue hits you, when you don't have energy, what do you call that? Think of it.
So this is the period where you celebrate it as a period of womanhood, and women are given more importance. That's why you find people doing Kumari Puja in Assam, which is also done here in South. So all over India, if you see, it is the period for celebrating womanhood, because in Indian thought, fundamentally, all these energies are associated with the woman principle in the cosmos, cosmic woman principle, and therefore women are also automatically celebrated. Now, one very interesting thing will therefore come up as, why is Mahishasura Mardini? So if you look at it, there are in all these places, if you see, one of the most celebrated form of the Shakti divinity, Durga, during this Navratri is the Mahishasura Mardini. We will look at it. I think it's just 10 minutes more to go. So we will look at it very quickly.
See, all of you know that in it's celebrated here in Bengal. As look at this Mahishasura Mardini representation. As she beautifully said, it's all about Shakti energy. What is the opposite of energy? Being tired. So that is the idea where you lethargy, overcome lethargy. How do you overcome lethargy? That is the idea of Mahishasura Mardini.
See, before you come to why Mahishasura Mardini itself, want to take you to our one of our recent books where you can read about it in detail. This is the book on Swami Ayyappa. It is there on our website for a free read. You can go and click on the book and read the book on the website. The word Mahisha means one. Mahish means king. At the same time, Mahisha also means buffalo. And if you look at it in Mahishasura Mardini, the form in which the asura was when the Devi kills him is the form of a buffalo. Now, what does buffalo signify? See, India has been a civilization where we have celebrated the bull in the Indus Valley. Right from the Indus Valley seals, you find the bull who is called a Rishabha. Now, the word Rishabha means, and the connotation of a bull, it means that one who is an exemplar, one who is great. So then you use a bull as a symbol. He's a bull among men, meaning he's the greatest among men. So while bull denotes greatness, buffalo denotes lethargy, negativeness. So bull has been used to symbolize positivity, while lethargy and all negativity has been depicted using buffalo.
Because the bull is so energetic, the buffalo is sort of, if you put it in a pond, it'll just lie down there, will not move at all. In a pool of water, it'll just lie down. Whereas a bull is so energetic.
So the buffalo symbolizes ignorance. It symbolizes lethargy, and therefore you will also see. See, even we have it in our daily use itself. You know, people dissuade you from drinking buffalo milk because that is so much of fat that will that it will make you more lethargic. It's called mandam.
You have the nice Tamil word mandam. It makes you mandam, very dull, slow.
And which is why you also find the divinity for death, Yama, actually Dharma, he is also. So he has his Vahana as a buffalo. And he comes riding on this because he is associated with taking the life of somebody. And what is life? Will life give itself up easily? Never. It's going to resist. There is going to be inertia. So bull, lethargy, inertia. So to overcome that inertia, that is why you have Yama who overcomes that inertia and pulls the life away. So that is how he has the bull. And this bull shows that you have to overcome inertia. And Mahishasura Mardini, in the form of Mahishasura Mardini, she is actually the one who helps you overcome this inertia. So that is why she celebrated. And typically, if you see, the period of winter is when you have these kind of feelings of inertia coming in more. So when the sun is away from you, there's not enough real physical energy in the form of light and everything to keep you going. So that inertia, how do you overcome? So that is when you need Mahishasura Mardini in your life to help you overcome all this, balance all your three energies, your thought, your speech, and your action, and help you lead a very balanced life even during times when the days and nights are imbalanced.
So when each of you listen to the song Mahishasura Mardini, you should relate to all these aspects, which is what is brought out of the song. And one of the best sculptures of Mahishasura Mardini is here near Chennai in Mamallapuram. Look, this is where it is. Look at the Devi here, Simha Vahini on a lion. And look at this Mahisha here with the buffalo head for his crown. Look at this. And look at the body pose. It's a static sculpture, but shows so much of movement, the way his leg is placed, the way his hand is. Look at the fingers. Look at his expression. So there's so much of action in a static image, which is a beautiful sculpture that is our heritage. It's our inheritance that we should be proud of and have here. This is there in this Mamallapuram cave, which all of you can go visit. This is there in this cave, Mahishasura Mardini. It's also here. You have one more here, Mahisha here, small Mahisha here inside the show temple in the lion. See there? It's here inside this. You can see that there. See, they can see it there inside this. The next time you go, just don't look at the show temple. See this also, this beautiful sculpture inside the small chest of the lion there.
Look and at when this. You look at any Mahishasura Mardini henceforth, remember this, what she's trying to give you. She's trying to give you the power to overcome inertia.
Look at this. Here in Tirunelveli, it's a small village. Here, small village. Same thing you have this here. Then you go to the famous Badami, Aihole. There you have this. Look at each a different post. There, the different Mahishas. All over the land, you have Mahishas. Then you go to Maharashtra, Karad. You have Mahisha there. Beautiful Mahisha. Sculpted over 700 years back. Each one a beauty. You go to Mumbai, you have this there. It's an old sculpture in the Elephanta Caves, unfortunately broken, but it's in the Elephanta Caves. Then you go to Madhya Pradesh. There you have Mahisha in the Udaygiri Caves. Look at this. Each is marvel. Real, each one is cultural marvel. You go to Rajasthan, you have it. Mahisha, this is in the Ambika Temple. Unfortunately, the head is broken here. Look at this beauty of it. That's there, a very old painting there. It's a probably 2000 years old Shunga painting. Look at this. So you have this all over the land. You have this Bengal in Shantiniketan were painted then. Shantiniketan is the institution which was started by Rabindranath Tagore there also. Then look at this. Go to Cambodia. The famed Bantaisrei temple there. You have the Mahishasura Mardini. So all over the land, you show Mahishasura Mardini, how it's represented so beautifully in different parts of the land. And this is how you get to see all these aspects.
So Navratri actually holds a wealth of significance to each of us. And in the south, we all know how we celebrate it in the form of Golu. And so a few points every time, whenever we see a Golu. Now, why do we celebrate it at this time of the year in the form of these dolls? One, we have just come through a season of summer, which is very conducive for making dolls, mud dolls, because you can dry them, and for making painted dolls, because the paints can dry. So this is a time, and also the agricultural activities will not be a big load during the times of summer. So people would get time to do all these kind of craft work and display them. But what kind of dolls did they do? They made dolls which depict the Puranic legends. So,
Want to speak about it, or you want to show somewhere?
Yeah, I want to show the book on.
Where you got all this. It's a book that we made. It's available for all of you for free read in a website. You can go to our website, bharatgyan.com. This is the book you'll get there in the mini book section. Look at this book. It speaks about, it's a probably 70 page book or what it is. You can all read the different types of
Navratri. The details are here.
All is there. Whatever we spoke about is there. You can share it to all your friends, family.
And we'll just wind up with a little bit of understanding of what this Golu tradition really means. So we have seen that this is a time when they can make all these dolls. It is ideal.
These are 9 stories about the 9 days of Navratri.
But what did they make during this? What kind of dolls did they make? They made Puranic legend dolls. So these dolls, these toys actually keep telling us about various legends of our land. And through this, they have kept the tradition of storytelling also alive. So they not only have we had people to tell stories or literature to write to us about, write and tell us about these stories and the legends, but these legends have also been depicted using toys as well to make it more realistic and more experiential. And that itself is the continuing tradition of this land.
And so beautifully brought out different. Look at this. So what you do is, when somebody makes a doll, they learn the stories and then they make the doll. So they are aware of the stories and show know what to make a doll. So the doll maker knows the stories. Then when the seller sells, the vendor sells it to you, he doesn't sell a product. He tells a story and sells it to you. So the maker knows the stories. He's imbibed with the dharma of the land, the stories of the land. The seller knows the stories to sell it to you. So he also knows about this. Then the person who puts up the all the children, the ladies, the girls, or the family members who make the Navratri Kulu and display it in the house, they know the story. So they display it according to the stories. Then when guests come to the house, what do? They explain the story. The children of the house, the ladies of the house, they tell the story to the visitors. So there's a chain of people. One, the maker of the doll in the villages, with the clay, with the wood, with the cloth, with the variety of products, they know the stories. They bring out the stories to the dolls. The seller tells the vendor tells the stories. The people who put up the Navratri in the temples or the house or in the schools, the colleges, the sabhas, they know the stories. They tell the stories. The visitors come to know the stories. See the sequence of how each one of them tell, learn, show the stories. That's the beauty of it. And if you look at it, that is how all the stories come about. Then you have nice foodies. Like Sundal, different foodies, different days, different food. So it's a food festival, it's a story festival, it's a nice dresses you wear, wonderful pavada davani, saris, different varieties of dress you wear. You bring out every aspect of, look at all these dolls in different parts of India. You have different dolls. You have it's the dolls in Russia. This is the Matryoshka dolls of Russia. Here you have the dolls here. Every variety of dolls you bring out. And look at this, this is in Japan. Look at this, so beautiful. So they have Kulu not only in India, in Tamil Nadu, you have Kulu in Japan. So look at this. Here is a Japanese lady coming to visit a Kulu in Tamil Nadu. That's the story of this. Here you have Dr. Hema Hari. When she visited Japan, she went for a Kulu, which is called Hina Matsuri in Japan. Same Kulu Padi in Japan, they have this Kulu with the Raja Rani on the top. And everybody here also you have the Raja Rani or Chettiar, all that you have stories. So look at this, a Japanese visiting a Kulu in Chennai at our place. Here is Dr. Hema Hari visiting in Japan, a Hina Matsuri Kulu there. So the contrast, this is also brought out in our book, Indo-Japan.
And it's, now here comes a more interesting part, okay? The number of steps that the Japanese keep in their Hina Matsuri, is also has to be odd, just like the Indian Kolu, where we keep odd number of steps. That is one. The other thing is they also celebrate it in the transition into spring. So for them, it's a transition period, but then they celebrate it for spring, just like we have seen in northern parts of India where the Vasant Navaratri is more celebrated. Here you find them celebrating the transition into spring. So fundamentally, you find ancient civilizations world over had understood that it is very important to keep aligning yourself with nature. And that is what Navaratri is, a time when you have to align.
So those who want more information about this, you can visit our website and our YouTube channel, our WordPress website. All this available. And if you go to our films, you got few hundred films on all these subjects. On our Twitter, we post on this daily. So please use all this knowledge to learn for ourselves about our wonderful civilization and share it in turn with all our friends and colleagues.
So I think with that, we will stop the sharing and
any questions, we
come
have
back
questions
to the session and take
questions if there are any.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hari and Dr. Hema Hari. That was a very enlightening and informative session. That was actually long years of research presented in an hour, and we are blessed to have got the chance to listen to this during this Navaratri. And I'm sure that this session will have motivated our students to know more about our rich Indian culture and heritage. Thank you, sir and ma'am. We do have a few questions in the chat box. There were a few students who asked, like Narmada, Vijayalakshmi, and all, who asked, why are we fasting, or what is the importance of fasting during the festivals like Varalakshmi Vratam and Navaratri?
Yeah, so I think we had explained what the meaning of the word vrat itself means. It means to contain. So contain your three major activities, your physical activity, your mental activity. So all three forms, your thoughts, your speech, your action. So when you try, so vrat is the time when you contain all three of them, try to balance them, try to, so the moment you still and calm them, that rejuvenates you. So that is why Vratam is seen as a time which is a period of rejuvenation. And different people try, give different focus. Some will take a Mauna Vrat, some will take a fasting for, you know, stilling and calming your digestive system so you don't eat on that day. Some take a Vrat in the form of meditation, which is just to still your mind.
Dhyanam. So dhyanam. You can do Maunam, you can do Dhyanam, or you can do Upavas, which is what you also do at Ekadashi, Upavas. And actually, if you see, we can say this is all very Indian tradition, all Ayurveda, yes. You know, last year, the Nobel Prize for Medicine was given to a Japanese doctor, scientist, who proved the scientific need in modern system for doing upavas on specified days that align with the earth, sun and moon, for which he got the Nobel Prize. So what you have been practicing here as a dinacharya, a daily regular practice. Acharya, achara means practices. Okay, desachara practice. Your practices of the land has got, because somebody explained it scientifically in modern medical language, he got the Nobel Prize for it.
He had explained what happens to the body when it fasts. So he could explain that
in medical terms.
So, whereas, so the same thing, you know, so this is fundamentally what our ancestors had understood and had therefore advocated as part of the Vrat. Very many forms of Vrat, different people can take up the form that is suitable to them, because each one is different. Each one of us is different. Our energies are different. What we need to balance is different. So we have to find out our own method and balance.
This article is there in our blog on this particular subject. Please read it on Ekadashi Vrat. It's there.
Thank you, sir. There's another question by Vishnu Priya. Is there a reason behind why the Golu Padi is always kept in odd numbers?
She already answered.
They want a reason why Golu Padi. I would think it goes fundamentally to our Indian psyche itself. Normally, you know, you end up in odd, which means perhaps there is another one to follow. So I think it shows that there is an increase. You don't stop.
See,
it doesn't conclude. See, it means it continues.
When you take steps, you know, when you walk steps, you say labam, nashtam, labam. You can again end with nashtam. When you build steps in a house.
See, there's a very old tradition. When you build a house, people always gave odd number of steps to the house also.
So when you enter step, first step is labam, second step is nashtam, third step is labam. Because labam, nashtam is a cycle. It's a continuous cycle. It's an unending cycle. Suham, dukkam is an unending cycle. So suham, dukkam, suham. You want to have suham, you don't have dukkam. So you will have three steps to a house. Suham, dukkam, suham. So in your house, you want to have suham in your house. So dukkam is part of life. Kasap is part of life. That's why you also enjoy your pavaka. That's why you have all the pachadi where you have pavaka in it, you have tega in it, you have vellam in it, everything, right, when you mix. And you also have that neem flower in it.
Yes.
So it's all part of the country. So you should understand that that's why you're the even odd, because labam, nashtam, labam. Suham, dukkam, suham. So you want to go out with suham.
Yes.
Right? That's how it is. Okay, next.
Yes, sir. There is a question from Deepa. She's asking that during Kulu seasons for 9 days, each day depicts some color and the people wear that color dress on that day. So is there any specific reason for that?
So traditionally, there have been reasons for it. It's nice to understand those reasons and have those colors. Like how we said, no, in Punjab, Haryana, the northwestern part of India, it's all yellow, carpet of yellow. If you go to Uttarakhand, Uttaranchal today, there's a valley of flowers. The whole hill slope is yellow. So the landscape takes that color. So when you have different types of festivals, when you go to the paddy fields, when it is just the sprouts come, it's light green. Then it becomes darker green, then it becomes brown when it's full of the paddy. So each one takes a beautiful color. So it's like that, each has a color to it.
And the 9 days, actually, if you see, each day is dedicated to one of the devis, one of the forms of energies.
Is there in a book, mini book, that the 9 days are there?
And these colors are supposed to be associated with these energies. See, in our Indian thought, there is a deep connection between color, between ragas, between stars, between plants,
trees.
Between stars, between trees, between animals. So everything, you know, they all kind of dovetail. There is a mapping. This maps to that, that map to this. And they all ultimately go towards impacting or affecting your guna, the three guna in your body. And the guna and the dosha of your body are connected. And all of this eventually go to make up you as a character, as a person with a behavior. So your behavior is affected by the dosha, by the guna. And these in turn are affected by the food you eat, the colors that you see, the sounds you hear, and everything around you. So that is how you are so intricately a part of nature. And the idea of wearing different colors is so that when you are trying to balance these energies, then, you know, sir, you can use these colors to help you, you know, focus better on that particular energy for the day. But then all this is if you are aware that you are actually balancing energies. So you have to first understand why you're celebrating Navratri, understand the inner meaning, go into the subtleties of all of this, understand that there is so much of subtlety in this, and then, you know, you will really be able to relate to it and leverage that color that day. It's not just, okay, today is yellow, so hey, I am in yellow, you are in yellow, everybody is in yellow, let's take a you know, pictures, let's take a selfie.
That's fine, but
that
beyond
is
that,
the
enjoy.
Celebrating, but to be able to understand that this is what you're wearing that yellow for.
What is the color of the blue, the yellow? Each one has a meaning to it. That's what you see. And she said one nice word. It's your guna, your character. Is that physical? Is it tangible? Is your character tangible? Can you feel your character with your hand or fingers? No. It's intangible. Your guna is intangible. Your character, but you exhibit it every moment of your life. Like that, all these aspects are intangible. It's intertwined in the intangibility of your character. The guna. It is so beautiful. But for all this, you have to think. You have to contemplate. That's the beauty of it.
Yes, thank you, sir. And there was a question by Pushpa. Why do the gods look different in the north and the south? Is there any specific reason for that?
See, all these are basically energies and forces and tattva principles. Each of this, the way you sit in your dhyana and the way you contemplate them and come up with them, you can showcase them in that way with their characteristics. It's all intertwined with your characteristics and their characteristics. You can show them the way they come up with you. That's why when a Vishwakarma is asked to make a vigraha in a temple or a sculpture, what do they do? Traditionally, we are supposed to go sit in dhyana. And the shape that comes to them in mind in their dhyanam is what they bring out as a vigraha, as a murti. Okay, that is how they bring it out beautifully. So that is what you experience. What they experience in the dhyanam is what they bring out for you to experience. It's not made to order, like, okay, you put one hand blue color, one hand green color, one this, that. No, no. It's all to do with where you sit down. You are in sync, in alignment with nature. You do dhyanam and out of it, it comes. So that is how each place has got its, because if you go to, say, Nepal or Tibet, the way they show it is with the slightly long eyes, they do all those things. If you go to some other place, they show it some other more chubby style. If you take a Thanjavur painting, so chubby and nice, isn't it? So cuddly, so chubby. Where you go to some other part, it's more sharper noses, sharper features. Each one is a variety like that you show so nicely in each place. Similarly, if you go to Cambodia, Thailand, Apsaras, look at the shape of the Apsaras face, eyes. It's so different, so beautiful.
See, another thing that influences these differences in design is the kind of local material. And local material used to make that art piece, the local tools they use to make the art piece. So all of these, so while on one side, the local mindset, you know, for different people, what appeals to them? What is their focus? What do they look for? So what resonates with them? That changes. The material changes, because depending on the type of stone, certain things are possible, certain things are not possible. So some of them will not lend themselves to fine work. Some of the kinds of wood will not lend themselves to fine work. So all of these together they go to shape the kind of product that you really bring out as a piece of art. And it is this differences which gives the land of India its diversity.
It's beauty. Like now we have different musical instruments. North you have Shehnai, here South you have Nadaswaram. There you have Tabla, here you have Mridangam. Both are nice percussion instruments. Both are nice wind instruments. You have string instruments. Here you have Veena, there you have got Sitar. So everything is nice. Both, each of the beauty, it's way of expression. This is all wonderful. That's a diversity of the land. The beauty of the land.
Thank you, sir. There's one more question. What can be done to change the mindset to make the lives of women more safer when we take the history or that historical perspective?
I think the knowledge, first of all, should help us to understand the narrative and the perspective. Because unfortunately, today we don't have that perspective, that knowledge. So, see, we showed you one slide where it said about dare and confidence. Okay, first, when you have this, you have a confidence about our civilization. Our civilization is a capable civilization, strong civilization, sustainable civilization, winning civilization. Our ideas are strong, in sync with nature, in sync with reality, respecting every aspect of society. Then
ideas meaning including all ideas, ideas about how we lived our day-to-day life, how the gender balance was maintained. So the women, how women were treated, I don't want to use the word treated, because it's how the women engaged themselves. Fundamentally, you know, the word, when you try to use the word empower itself, means somebody has to give you the power to do. So women empowerment in that sense itself defeats the purpose of uplifting the women.
That means somebody else is superior to you to give you the power. So you are willingly, when you use the word empowerment, you're saying somebody else is better. Somebody else has higher power. No, that's totally wrong. We don't have women's empowerment thought at all. We have women are not equal. They're complementary. In English, what do you say for that? Behind every successful man, there is a woman. That means what? What does it mean? Woman is behind the man. That itself says that defeats it. Straight away, the woman is behind the man. So wrong.
We so sometime have, I think maybe for your all the college, girls we can in your only college, on
it is on not woman. Equality. It's complementary. What is your in the Indian thought? Ardhanari. A woman has equal half with the men. Ardhanari, Ardha, half. So they are complementary nature. They're not equal. Equal means you have to give some them equality. No. Women have it by their own right. They are not, in Indian thought, women are not behind men.
So this is the thought we'll have to start instilling in generally in the minds of both men and women so that they both understand where they have to come from.
You can read our article and our book on this, especially in our book, Breaking the Myths About Society. We have dealt one full chapter only on this word. Is women behind men or is it Ardhanari? The difference between equality, women's equality or women's complementary. Women's equality is no. We don't want women's equality. We want women complementary. You don't have to fight for equality. You cannot fight for equality. You're better. So that means you're complementary. That is that much one step ahead. That's what we can do some other time, another session. But this is a whole topic by itself.
Thank you very much, sir and ma'am, for patiently answering all the questions. Now, may I request Anita Mary, Assistant Professor, Department of Psychology, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Well, we'd like to also thank your director for asking us to make this presentation to all of you, Dr. Lata Rajan, and your principal, ma'am, Dr. Mani Meghalit. Thanks to both of you. And thanks for anchoring the session, ma'am. Yes.
A very good morning to everyone and all present here. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks for this enlightening session. Let me first start by thanking God Almighty, who has kept us and our families safe in this time of crisis and who has brought us all as one here today. It is indeed a privilege for me to thank our amazing speakers for the day, Dr. D.K. Hari and Dr. D.K. Hema Hari, founders of Bharat Gyan. This session did definitely do justice to the purpose of being an eye-opener. We all have learned so much about this whole festive season in India and how important it is. I personally was absolutely ignorant that there was so much of history actually behind it. And I would not even watch the movie Rang De Basanti the same way again. There was so much of beauty of India and our culture that you all brought out in your presentation that maybe we over time took for granted, and this whole purity somewhere got diluted over the years. There was so much about us as women that we're not even aware of, you know, and so much we could be proud of as, you know, women. We actually contribute to the balance and the alignment of the universe itself. And so much more that we need to learn about ourselves and our culture as well. So thank you so much, and also for being so patient and answering all our queries as well. My deep gratitude goes to our correspondent, Dr. Lata Rajendran and Mr. Kumar Rajendran, for our chairman, for their continuous support as well. I would like to thank, you know, our dear principal, Dr. R. Mani Meghalai, and our vice principal, Dr. Lakshmi Balaji, for their never-ending guidance and support. My heartfelt gratitude goes out to Dr. Shanti Lakshmi, Dean of Academics, and Dr. Apita Sadapti, Dean of Students, for their help in making today's event possible. Last, but definitely not the least, I would like to thank each and every one of you all for joining us and making this session a huge success as well. Thank you all once again, and have a great day.